Hi everyone, welcome to CSE 160, Computer Science A for Honors. Today we will go over basically the information about what is the class about, how do we held the class. The class also has a lab that is associated with the class, and we'll basically talk about the first chapter, Introduction to Programming. So your starting point for every course at Stony Brook is Blackboard. So on Blackboard in announcements, I basically put a bunch of announcements. One, and probably the most important for you today, is the Zoom link for the lecture and labs. So we are going to use this URL, which you follow to actually join the class today. The course website, which contains the syllabus and the lecture notes for all of the classes this semester. I'm updating these lecture notes up to the last moment before the lecture, is on the computer science department. It's basically a link that works for this class and other classes that I've used. And I will show you this webpage in a few moments. Basically contains the lecture notes, the syllabus, and reading materials for every single lecture. Also on Blackboard, there is the link to Piazza. So we are using Piazza for discussion groups and any questions about the class, public questions. You can always also write me email if you have a question. The sign-up link is on Blackboard. Most of you already enrolled. I saw in Piazza that basically several students already enrolled. I can't actually find how to see the students that are enrolled, but earlier when I managed the class, I've been able to see a lot of students. Also, I have my TAs on Piazza. So currently I see several students in the class, 55 students enrolled. So exactly what we expected. I will go over Piazza and my TAs in a few minutes too. By the way, anytime you have any questions, feel free to stop and ask me, but I will try to cover as much as possible to understand what is the class about, what's the requirements of this class, the grading schema and so on. Also, you will find a couple of useful announcements on Blackboard. So one announcement are all of the computer science clubs. So there is the Stony Brook Computing Society, is the oldest club, I believe, on campus. It started when the department started back in the 1980s. And basically now is located on Facebook. It has 5,000 members, students that are in computer science now, students that graduated. Then there is the Women in Computer Science, the link to Facebook Wix page, and the Stony Brook Game Developers. These are the biggest computer science groups on campus. The Stony Brook Game Developers is coordinated by Professor Richard McKenna, that you will probably meet him in many of the classes that you will take at Stony Brook. He's teaching the front-end development class. He's teaching the game development classes, and also sometimes he's teaching 416, our software engineering class, the capstone project class for this major. I see two messages in the chat. You can always also join the chat and ask questions. I see the question is that if we just joined, this lecture is recorded. So basically it will be posted both on Zoom recordings and on YouTube later. There are also links about Wix, what you saw at the beginning of the class today, the official webpage for Wix, the Facebook group again, the Instagram group, a sign up to the mailing list, and the direct email to Wix. Also, there is an announcement about internships. Many of the students that took computer science at Stony Brook actually got into internships. I had the student that took with me CSA 114, and the following summer, he was an intern at Bloomberg. And I basically listed a bunch of companies. So these are financial companies that hire Stony Brook interns and full-time employees, tech companies that hire Stony Brook students. My advice is to basically apply early as you can. Sometimes you can, now being a pandemic year, I would say that you can even apply this semester and see what happens. My first internship at IBM was actually quite a non-programming internship. I was hired to actually listen to recordings on their help desk and correct the natural language transcription. So that was an internship at IBM, a paid internship, and it was quite useful later to actually have an internship and a contractor job to work in the IBM Watson project that played with Champions of the Jeopardy game. So basically it's easy to search for such jobs, like you Google internship and the name of the company, and then you follow the links. For Google, I put the direct link if you are interested. For Microsoft and other companies, you do the same. Most of these internships also require a resume, so you should have prepare a resume and maybe go to the VIX, the Women in Computer Science events to actually go over your resume and improve it. Also to exercise a few interviews. They also ask for 1 to 3 references or contacts, and you can always give me, since you are taking my class, as a contact or a reference. So, first link that I basically mentioned on the announcement page on Blackboard for this class is the course website. So the course website basically contains 2 pages. One is the lecture notes page. It starts with the course description. It's actually the course description from the undergraduate bulletin. This is the first part of a 2-sequence course, CSE 160 and 260. And it's an introduction to procedural and object-oriented programming. In this class, we use Java, and actually the reason is that it's probably the best for Computer Science 1 class, because it is between C and Python. So C is very low level, you work with pointers, the object-oriented programming only was introduced in C++, and even the notions that C++ uses is a little bit old. Like, for instance, they use virtual for abstract classes, which is the standard terminology for object-oriented programming. They don't have interfaces and so on. So in Java, also you have types. So it's better than basically more simplified scripting languages like Python, where types are actually hidden. You actually need to know more programming to understand what happens underneath than actually Java, where you specify the type of the object that you want to define. There are standard types. You have the primitive types, and then you have the object-oriented types or reference types. And we'll talk more about that. But basically this semester we'll start with procedural programming, where you write methods and you have a main method that is executed line by line. And basically it calls other methods. So you have a workflow of execution. We'll cover conditional statements, arrays, object-oriented programming, and we'll basically get into details in lower level programming, including exceptions, very important topic, basic data structures. And this semester we'll actually do a little bit more than last semester in this class, last time I taught this class. We'll actually get into data structures like queues and stacks, maybe even into trees or how to represent trees. Next semester, those of you that will take CSE 260 Computer Science B honors, we will get into more detailed data structures like AVL trees, RedLeg trees, graphs and graph algorithms, and then into principles of programming languages. You will see how a programming language actually is parsed, then compiled into an abstract interpretation, and then optimized and executed. I have a YouTube channel for a past semester recordings, actually for CSE 114, the equivalent not honor class. But I will also create a YouTube channel for this semester. And if you want to follow it, you will basically see that the lectures for basically this class are available. I will post the lectures for this class and you can watch it again. Or if you miss the class, you can watch it and prepare for the class. I will introduce myself in a few moments when we actually go over the class information, grading schema, and the rules of the class. My name is Paul Fodor. I'm a faculty at Stony Brook since 2010. Before that, I did my PhD at Stony Brook and my master at Stony Brook. I came to Stony Brook in 2003, and then I did my master. I did my PhD. I worked for IBM and for a few other companies. And I'm also associate professor of practice now. The office hours for this class are on Google Meet. And my office hours are Mondays and Wednesdays from 4 to 5:30. Some of you actually came today to ask questions about the class. And we'll talk more about that now because we have the syllabus handy. My email, my direct email is paul.fodor@stonybrook.edu, and the class time and the lab time are basically posted here. So the class is Mondays and Wednesdays from 6:05 to 7:25. We have a standard lecture slot on Zoom, and that Zoom link is posted on Zoom on Blackboard as the first link, first announcement. The lab follows the class, but only after 25 minutes. You see that basically what I think Stony Brook decided is to have these breaks between classes in case that basically students want to take a break or maybe dinner in this case. So it's from 7:50 to 9:10. We'll follow the schedule that is posted on PeopleSoft on Solar. So basically, the lecture will be followed by the lab, also on the same Zoom. The lecture notes for the entire semester and associated reading assignments are also posted on this website, the course website that is linked on Blackboard. And we'll start today with the first two lectures because we had the snow day on Monday. We'll basically cover the administrative information and the syllabus. And we'll try to finish also the introduction to computers, programs, and Java. This is a low level introduction to programming, really what we are trying to do in this case, and which corresponds to the first chapter in our textbook. Now, the syllabus of the class is actually also on the same page. So if you click on syllabus, you actually get the syllabus for this class. And we'll go over this syllabus in a few moments with basically with slides, okay? So I will go over what are the course outcomes. So if you follow the link to our equivalent, basically course bulletin, you will find the description, you will find the prerequisites. You have to be an honors student, either in the computer science department or honors college or vice or university scholars. The core requisite of this class is the lab, CSE 161, which actually has the same grade with CSE 160. So it's basically just, this is the class of 3 credits and there's the lab for 1 credit. It also satisfies the tech requirement for SBC's Stony Brook curriculum. The course outcomes agreed by all the faculty that teach this class and which are used in the accreditation of our program undergraduate degree with an organization called ABET, which is a non-governmental organization that standardizes engineering programs, are the ones that are listed here and we'll go over in a few moments. The textbook that we are using is posted on in the syllabus. So we use Introduction to Java Programming by Daniel Young. I recommend the comprehensive version because the comprehensive version contains not only the material that we cover in CSE 160, but also CSE 260. So it's one textbook for the whole, both classes. We'll cover up to chapter 18 in CSC 160, and we'll basically cover the rest of the 18 chapters in CSC 260. And there are many different ways to basically read the textbook. You can purchase the textbook from Amazon, which is our official book store this year, or you can basically get the electronic version from Pearson. It's optional, I'm not requiring the textbook. So in fact, I try to cover in my lecture notes that you will see in a couple of minutes, everything that I find useful and important for you. The problems that will be part of the homeworks will also be listed. Basically, here is the problem. There will be no references that you have to go to the textbook to actually find that problem. I will go over the grading schema in a few moments and other requirements for this class. So let's go over basically the syllabus. So I already told you that this is the first part of a two-semester course, CSC 160 and 260. It's an introduction to procedural programming and object-oriented programming. Procedural is basically the idea that you have a workflow that will be executed from start to end. And it was introduced by John von Neumann in basically 1950s as part of the ENIAC computer, a computer developed at the Naval Research Lab. And the idea of that is that exactly this, that you have a sequence of instructions that is executed. And at those times it was basically on tapes and was every single instruction was machine language. These days, we also abstract. Some instructions are actually a method name, and then you have a jump to that method to execute the steps in that method. When you finish the method, you can come back to the caller to that method. So this is procedural programming. You have procedures, you execute one main method, step by step from top to bottom. Object-oriented programming is a different technology where you actually define patterns, like what is a person and what are the fields, the properties that person has. And then you can create multiple instances. So if you want to keep a database of people, you basically create multiple instances of the same class. And these instances are called objects. It simplified a lot graphical user interfaces because graphical user interfaces are standardized in this way. You basically have components like buttons, checkboxes, radio buttons, and so on. And you can create multiple instances that you need. You need radio buttons for color or radio buttons for the type of text, italic, bold, and so on. And you can just basically create different objects given the classes that already exist in that framework. Similarly for data structures, you want a stack or you want a different kind of data structure, you can basically just create an instance of that class that was defined before. So the different topics of this class include program structure, like what is the main method, what are ways to define or syntax to define classes, methods, packages, and so on. Conditional statements, those are the equivalent of natural language if-then statements. Iterative statements, those are the equivalent of loops. You want to execute over the entire collection, the same set of instructions. That is called an iteration. You basically give the collection or you define how it will execute this iteration, like for every integer I from 1 to 10, you execute some block. Usually you iterate over the elements of an array, over a list, or basically the characters of a string. Then we will learn how to write procedures or methods, basically these abstracted methods that you can, like sinus, cosinus in math, you just call it. It has an internal execution, it returns the result. Then we'll learn our basic data structures like arrays. An array is a sequence of elements of the same type. And the advantage of an array is that you can actually store it in memory where every single element has the same size. So if you want to find an element at any index, like I want to find the 10th element, you can find it in constant time because you multiply the size of an element with the index, and that gives you exactly the address of that element that you're looking for. So we'll learn about arrays, which are basically lists of elements, which you can access either for reading or writing in constant time. We'll learn about classes, basically these patterns that you can define to actually instantiate multiple objects. We'll learn object-oriented programming concepts like encapsulation, that you don't need to know the internal definition of a class. Encapsulation means that you only have a public signature of the class, which are the list of public methods. How they are implemented internally, it's basically the developer of that class problem. So that's hiding the basically unimportant details. As a user, a programmer user, you only want to know the application interface for that basic class. We will learn inheritance. If you define a superclass like person and you want to define student or faculty or staff, basically you can inherit all the properties from the superclass like name and so on without having to duplicate information, duplicate code. So you can define a subclass that inherits all of the properties of the superclass. We will learn about polymorphism. Basically what happens when you define a method in the subclass that overrides the method in the superclass. We'll learn how to read and write to files, how you can return from a method without returning a value, that's called an exception. So a method is not quite like a function in mathematics. Functions in mathematics are well-defined. When you define a function like sinus, it's defined on all real numbers as the domain, with values in the codomain, let's say also all real numbers. However, in programming, sometimes you have values in the domain for which you can't return a value. So basically in that case, you have a different kind of result, which are called exceptions. And we'll see these other simple data structures like arrays, but with different functionality, like lists, queues, and stacks. Again, the prerequisites of this class are computer science honors or honors college or women in engineering program or university scholars. The course outcomes that are agreed by all the faculty that teach this course, Professor Bender, who is the honors coordinator in the department, in the computer science department, the undergraduate director, Professor Kevin McDonald's, and every single other faculty that teaches the course, are an ability to program in procedural and object-oriented language using concepts such as loops, methods, object classes, encapsulation, inheritance, and polymorphism. An ability to use and define data, fundamental data structures such as arrays, stacks, and queues. And an ability to program with sound code structure and use systematic debugging and testing techniques. So at the end of this semester, you will have these abilities, basic programming, ability to use data structures and to debug code. That's what is important for a programmer, a beginner programmer. So we'll basically focus in this class in different areas. We'll start with an introduction to programming in Java. You don't need to have any programming prerequisite in this class. We'll basically cover everything that needs to be covered in this class. This class does not have a programming prerequisite. As long as you know math up to basically high school level, you will be fine in this class. So we'll start learning programming in Java with conditional statements, loops, methods. Then we'll learn about fundamental data structures like arrays, lists, and stacks. We'll learn what algorithms are and how to write an algorithm. An algorithm is basically a sequence of instruction that has a correct result. We'll learn that algorithms are sound. and complete. You find all the results if the algorithm is good. Then we'll learn basic concepts of object-oriented programming, how to declare a class, how to encapsulate it, how to use inheritance, polymorphism, and we'll actually use it for graphic user interfaces. So what I want at the end of this class is to be able to write an application that has a graphical user interface that you can basically show the result in a nice GUI, basically graphical user interface, like for instance, PowerPoint or Photoshop. Basically, you will not develop those applications, but you will know how to define a nice little application to like a game, okay? And this class has a lot of programming assignments. So basically you will see that there will be five to six problems per lab. Then those are practice problems. So you will submit them on Blackboard, but they will be graded very high level. So as long as the functionality is there, you will get the credit for the lab. Then there will be homework assignments. Homework assignments are more complex. Usually it's one problem that is very complicated and you have to be precise when you follow the instructions. You know what methods to implement, how to implement them, what to return for every single method. And then you will learn during the lab systematic testing techniques, okay? Any questions up to now?
I have a question.
Yes.
So do you have an access code for the textbook, the My Programming Lab online?
So basically the access code comes with the textbook. So the textbook is actually, so when you purchase the textbook, that's where the access code is. I'm not requiring My Programming Lab. It's a good resource, but only if you purchase the textbook, you will have the access code to use it. Okay, it's part of the textbook. Basically, if you want My Programming Lab, you basically need to get the textbook.
Okay.
I will not give assignments from My Programming Lab. All assignments will be in the lab. They will be in Blackboard. That includes the lab and the program and the homework assignments. My Programming Lab is a good tool, don't get me wrong, but I don't want you to, it's not a mandatory, as you will see in a few moments when we go over the textbook. The textbook is optional. So it's really up to you if you want to purchase the textbook and the My Programming Lab. It's useful, especially if you're a beginner programmer. It has about 500 problems and they start with basically you are given a small text box. How do you define a variable X of the type real? And you basically have to define double X semicolon. And it's a good tool to start with easy statements, but hopefully you will learn this by doing a lot of programming in this class, 6 problems per lab. The TAs will actually, and me, I will actually do the first lab next Monday, in which basically I will start by opening Eclipse, installing Eclipse, and writing my first program for you. So you will basically see how to write the program. It will be recorded. You can watch the recording as many times as you want, and you will learn by practicing. My Programming Lab, as I said, is a resource that comes with the textbook, and the textbook is not free. Okay. So information about myself. I am Professor Paul Fodor. My office is in room 214 in the New Computer Science Building. My office hours are Mondays and Wednesdays from 4 to 5:30. My email is paul.fodor@stonybrook.edu. If you write me email, usually for private issues, because we have a piazza that basically we use for general issues. Like if you want to ask anything about problems, syllabus, labs, you can use piazza. It may be useful for other colleagues of yours. But if you have a private question, like for instance, your homework grade, or your exam grade and you want to review it or something, then you write me an email because you don't want to, that's a private issue. So basically just start the email with CSE160 and I will respond. Use your Stony Brook email because due to regulations like the FERPA regulation, Federal Education Privacy Act, I'm not actually allowed to respond to non-Stony Brook emails because I do not know if lily@gmail is actually you. And I'm actually not allowed to communicate about class issues with lily@gmail. I don't know who lily@gmail is. Lily is my dog. So for questions about the class, general questions about the class, public questions, you can use Piazza. Blackboard will be used for all assignments, submission, the grades posting, and the other course material that is individual and private. And the course website is also linked from the lecture notes. Again, this class meets on Mondays and Wednesdays from 6:05 to 7:25 online on Zoom. The lab follows the class 25 minutes later, also on the same Zoom. The textbook is optional. It's called Introduction to Java Programming by Daniel Liang. It's a very good textbook. I basically use it for 10 years, both in CSE 160 and 114. If you look on Amazon, it has thousands of reviews and good reviews. It's a textbook that covers Java programming in very much detail. I'm actually using the Python version when I teach principles of programming languages. The same author wrote the Python version of this textbook, and I find the textbook extremely good. It has a lot of problems. There is an associated website with the textbook where every single even number exercise in the textbook is actually solved. So for you to see how good solutions for those problems are written. Those are the even number exercises. And then odd number exercises are really for practicing. The textbook is relatively recent, 2017. There is actually a Python version of the textbook, the one that I mentioned earlier, that is 2021. So it's only released this year. So the textbook is very current. The necessary software in this class are the Java Developer Kit, JDK, and Eclipse IDE. Both tools come for free. Basically, you can follow these links to download. For Java, you have to download the version of Java that corresponds to your operating system. So usually these are two or three versions. If you have Windows, you download the Windows version, 64-bit mostly, because I would assume that you have a laptop or a desktop that is relatively recent. For a Mac, you download the Mac version 64-bit. For Linux, Ubuntu, Debian, or any other versions of Linux, you download the Linux version. And then you install it and you have JDK on your machine. You also download the Eclipse IDE. It's basically, so Java doesn't come with an editor. You will download some editor. The one that is standard for this class and I'm using is Eclipse. There are many other IDEs for Java, IntelliJ, NetBeans, that's the one that actually is developed by Oracle, the developer of Java, the owner of Java programming language. You can write actually Java programs in Notepad. Its source code is a text file. So you can write a text file in Notepad, save it with extension.java and the same name of the file that you use for the class. And then you can compile your Java program with Java C and run it with Java, the JVM, the Java Virtual Machine. The cost for both of these software are basically free. There are a few questions on the chat. Can we use a different IDE? Yes, I just basically told you that you can use NetBeans, IntelliJ, BlueJ, and so on, many different. Good. Do you need a special version of JDK? Very good question. So I personally use JDK 8. So let me tell you a little bit about Java history. So Java was originally developed by a company called Sun. So Sun developed Java, and their idea was that you write Java code anywhere, you compile it, and then you can run it anywhere. So you write Java, you can run it anywhere. Java was released in 1995, and basically up to, I would imagine, up to Java 5 was owned by Sun. Sun was bought by Oracle. And Oracle basically continued developing Java up to JDK or Java 8, JDK 1.8 or Java 8. It followed the same license. And the license was that basically this is a program supported by Oracle, but it's really under an open JDK or open Java development kit. Since version 1.8, Java Oracle changed the license. So the license today for Java is that you can develop programs, but if you use them in commercial applications, you basically have to buy a license for Java. I personally, I'm fine with using JDK 1.8. So I usually, when I download Java, I download the latest version of 1.8 because that was the most permissive license. So the programs that I write for JDK 1.8. So I use the features in JDK 1.8. Everything in JDK 1.8 is backward compatible. So basically everything that was written in Java for the entire history of Java up to 1.8 can be run. Since 1.9, I believe today is Java 12, Java is not backward compatible anymore. So basically means that code that you compiled and you wrote for previous versions of Java are not necessarily, they cannot be run in newer versions of Java. In fact, JDK, Open JDK, which is an open version of JDK developed by a consortium, it's not, it still uses the same license as the original Java. So personally, what I would recommend you is to download JDK 1.8 or Open JDK 1.8. Okay. But it doesn't matter if you download the latest version of Java. It's just that I prefer that version because of the open license. That's it. Okay. But no matter what version of Java you download, if you download the equivalent version of Eclipse, it will work. So Eclipse is basically written in Java itself. You can basically edit, you can change the IDE Java Virtual Machine to any version of Java that you use. So I personally use Eclipse 2019, but you can download the last year, Eclipse 2020. When you create a new project, and I will show you how to do that in a few seconds, you can define also what version of Java you want to use. Okay, so let's, after you download Java and you install it and you download Eclipse, you can start Eclipse. You can create a new Java project. And you can see already that I'm using a JRE, a Java environment, running environment, which is JDK JRE 1.8.0.201. I believe that this is a quite recent JDK release. Well, let's create actually a project since we are here, CSE 160. And in fact, we can actually create our first Java program. You can watch the recording later if you want to see how I did that. So let's call it Hello CSC 160. I will also add the main method. This is how a Java program looks like. And let's put here a bunch of statements. I, CSC 160 students. Every single statement in Java ends with semicolon. This is a requirement. In Python, you can optionally end with semicolon or not. In Java, it's a requirement. Similarly, in JavaScript, you can end with semicolon or not. In Java, is a requirement. And then you can have multiple statements. So you can actually see that these are executed. So let's go in sequence as they are written. So another statement. And yet another one. So an IDE lets you basically run a program and see the result without having to compile first the program and then to run it. So you can see that the statements were executed in the order that they appeared in this main method. So first we have hi, Stony Brook students, a CSC 160 students in the console or command prompt. Then we have the another statement, and then we have the yet another statement. An IDE also lets you debug the code. So you can double click on the side of the program and that creates a breakpoint. And then instead of running the program, you click on this bug. So that opens a different perspective called the debugger. And the debugger lets you execute the program line by line. So you can basically execute the first line and then you see the output. Then you execute the second line and then you see the output and you execute the next line. You can also step into the methods to see what happens, or you can continue executing to the end. So this is the debugger. You can switch between the perspectives, the Java perspective and the debugging perspective. Another thing in the debugger is when we define variables, like let's say define the variable int I equal with one, and you execute step by step, you can also basically see the values for every single variable that you have in the program. Okay. So for the same breakpoint that we had before, let's run the debugger again. So now you can see the value of I is one. Then you execute the next statement, and I is changed to two. So debugger basically lets you to actually see the execution of your code line by line. Okay. So this is how you write Java programs. Okay. So these are basically everything you need in this class, Java, developer kit and Eclipse IDE. Okay, so let's return back to the syllabus. So the grades in this class are based on homework exams and labs according to the following formula. First, the homework assignments are 15% of the grade. The labs are 10% of the grade. The midterm exams, there will be two midterm exams, are 50%, 25% each. And the final exam is 25%. So there are basically three exams. One is in March, one is in April, and one is in May, which basically cover the first part of the semester. Then the second midterm is not cumulative. So it covers what is covered between midterm one and midterm two. And then we have the final exam, which is cumulative. Cumulative in the sense that basically it's a final exam with 10 problems that you have to implement. And you basically need to know everything that you learn in this class. So you don't need to basically only know what is at the end. No, it's a final exam that covers the entire class. CSC 160 is the lab CSC 161 is the lab for 160. And you get the same grade that you got in 160 assigned to 161, okay? Now, there will be seven homework assignments. Every 2 weeks, there is a homework assignment. There will be labs every lab following the lecture. We'll start these labs next week. We need to cover a bit of programming before we can actually practice these things. And basically that's all. So you can see that we sum up all the assignments. Different assignments have different number of points. Then we factor that to the total points that you can compute, that you can earn from assignments. And we can compute out of 15 final points, how many points did you get from assignments. The labs are in the same way. Every lab is 3 points. They sum up to a number of points for 26 labs. Then you can miss up to 3 labs without penalty. That's because basically maybe you don't have the time that day of the lecture to submit your lab. The labs are due at midnight. So basically we cover them in the lab. We'll cover first what problems need to be solved, like 3 out of 6. And then you basically have to solve by the end of the day, either that you do it during that lab or you do it later. You have to submit on Blackboard those problems to get the credit for the lab. That's basically it. Now, the grades are computed based on what is basically the best of two worlds. First of all, there is the fixed cutoffs, saying that if you earn over 95, including 95, you basically are guaranteed that you get an A. If you earn over 90, up to 95, you're guaranteed that you get at least an A minus. If you earn over 87, you have at least a B plus, and so on. Then there is a special rule that says if all of your grades, including the homework assignments, quizzes, recitations, and your 3 exams grades are above the respective class average, you are guaranteed to get at least a C in the class. So if the average of the class is actually below 73, let's say 65, you are guaranteed that we get a C. So basically, this is a C curve. It says that even if the average is lower than this 73, the minimum for a C, you can still earn at least a C. So the entire cutoffs are actually shifted down with what is the difference between the minimum for a C and what's the actual average of the class. So the cutoffs that you see here guarantee that that's the minimum grade that you can get. Like for instance, if you get, let's say a 77, you are guaranteed that you get at least a C plus, but it may be higher, okay? Because if the average of the class is below 73, then the entire cutoffs shift down with that number of points between 73 and the actual average of the class. Usually I have to tell you that basically the average in an honors class like this one, it's above 73. So usually we never have to apply this special rule. But in case that something unexpected happens, we may have to apply the special rule. There will be also extra credit problems. So sometimes I include them as more difficult problems in the homework assignment. Sometimes it's an 11th problem in the exam that is over the 25% for that exam. But overall, all of these extra assignments will be less than 4% of the final grade. If I have any kind of extra assignments, I have to put them in the syllabus. So the syllabus has to contain this fact that if there are extra assignments, you can gain out of these extra assignments at most 4%. 4% is about 1 letter grade. So you can see that basically the distance between B plus and B is 3 points. Between B and B minus is 4 points. So really this 4% says that if you do all the extra assignments, you will get at least one grade up, okay? The dates for the exams are the following. Monday, March 8th is our first midterm. That's the 6th week of classes. It's going to take during class time for 80 minutes. That's the time of our class. The second midterm will be on Wednesday, April 7, also during class time. The final exam is set by the final exam schedule for basically Stony Brook final exams, which basically guarantees that there are no other final exams that you have for other classes based on our time slot of 6:05 to 7:25. And that is on Wednesday, May 12, from 8:30 to 10:30 p.m. It's a 2-hour final exam. The slot that actually the registrar lists is from 8:30 to 11, but that's because they consider also that maybe some other exams, final exams are, so that's the maximum time, but we are only using 2 hours for our final exam. So basically, usually when you give exams in person, people need to move from room to room. Some organization has to be taking place, like who's sitting where. In our case, basically we have online exams. These are all using Responders logged-on browser with monitoring. So basically you need to download this software, which is a browser like Chrome, but it only lets you open one tab and you take the exam in Blackboard. When you finish, you close it and that's it. Okay. Monitoring records video. So basically we can see that it's only you taking the exam and nobody else. The exam will be like the problems that we solve in class. So sometimes the questions that I get are what problems will come on the exam. And I can only tell you that they are basically like the ones that we solve in class or during the lab. I can't tell you the problems before the exam. The assignments are due on fixed dates. So usually 2 weeks before the assignment is due, no late submission is permitted. So we don't have any kind of special rules that if you submit 1 day after the deadline, then you lose some percentage. No, we are very clear that you basically take the exam and you submit the solutions by midnight some day. And that's it. After that, it will disappear from Blackboard and you can't submit it anymore. All assignments should be submitted electronically on Blackboard. There is no text website this semester. As I said, the textbook is optional. The labs are coding exercises that you basically have the lab time. And actually this semester I will let you until the midnight. So in case that you cannot make the lab, you can still solve the lab later and submit it, okay? Attendance is mandatory if you want the credit. So basically if you, attendance means that you submit the lab on Blackboard. I can't check who's currently logged in and things like that. And if all the code compiles and works properly, you get basically 3 points for the lab. And then there are other cases where you didn't submit anything or the program doesn't compile, we can't give you the credit, or you submitted something which is, again, has major problems, we can't again give you credit. Or if there are errors, usually I can tell you that labs are binary grading. So it's either 0 that you didn't attend the lab or didn't submit any Java source code, or you submitted at least a problem from the lab. If you need any kind of regrading, like for instance, the grades for the homework were posted or the grades for the exam were posted, and you need to see a TA for some problem, then you basically need to see a TA or myself to arrange for regrading within a week. So let's say that I grade homework 1, I post a message on Piazza that your grades for homework 1 are available on Blackboard. You have 1 week, which basically means 2 sets of office hours for me and for all of my TAs, to see us during office hours and regrade your homework. We have office hours on Google Meet. You join the Google Meet. If there is no one else there, you basically share your screen and show us the problem. If there is somebody else there, we have a private Google Meet. So basically we'll put in the chat another link, you join that one, leave the current, the public one, and you show us the problem, and then we help you with regrading. The problem is that I teach other classes. I have CSE 114, which is 120 students. I have a graduate seminar. I basically advise students. I just cannot regrade. At the end of the semester, I can't grade problems that you had from homework one, let's say. Okay, so really we have a 1 week from the day that the grades were announced to see us. You have the opportunity to see us during two sets of office hours and the TA's office hours, which I have about five TAs for this class. This is the schedule for the class. So we'll cover Introduction to Java Programming this week. Next week, Elementary Programming and Selection Statements. The following week, Mathematical Functions, Strings, and Loops. The next week, week number four, Methods, then Arrays. We'll have the first midterm, then Multidimensional Arrays, then Object-Oriented Programming, Inheritance, Exceptions, Abstract Classes and Interfaces, and we have the second midterm, and then we have Event Programming and Graphical User Interfaces and Recursion, and we have the final. This semester is 14 weeks with no break, so be very careful that basically everything is quite intensive. You will learn Java programming in 14 weeks with no single break. If you have, if you need accessibility support, basically the accessibility support is available at this phone number, and they also have an email. You can basically search online for Student Accessibility Support Center, Stony Brook. If you require assistance, this semester we don't have classes in person. So you basically, again, you can follow up that website. All documentation of disability is confidential. If I get emails that you are taking the exam in a special circumstance, I basically will follow the requirements of the Student Accessibility Support Center. A very important issue that I want to cover in the first class is academic integrity. This rule is posted in every single course at Stony Brook. Each student must pursue his or her academic goals honestly and be personally accountable for all submitted work. Representing another person's work as your own is always wrong. Any suspected instance of academic dishonesty will be reported to the academic judiciary. This is required for every single faculty teaching at Stony Brook. And then there is a website where you will find details. But I will go into details, basically, what can you discuss and not what you cannot discuss in this class. Like, for instance, you can discuss general assignment concepts, like what does the problem ask for? Give me examples of what do input, what output corresponds to that input, okay? Higher level design issues, like in words, tell me how to implement this. Okay, that's fine. No source code, okay? You may not share assignments either on Piazza or by email or by Discord or by any other way, Messenger, by looking at the code, somebody else's code, retyping, supplying a file, that's usually what basically dishonesty means. And one thing that I can tell you is that all assignments in this class and other computer science classes are checked automatically by programs developed at Stony Brook and Stanford. We basically have tools which do an amazing job. Basically, I can tell you that it tells me with percentage how much similarity are between any two students in the class. And if we find any instance of cheating, we, by rules, we have to bring it to academic judiciary, okay? And that's following the university policy. And I will give you examples of what academic dishonesty means. For instance, unpermitted collaboration on a paper, on a homework, on labs, Unless the instructor explicitly approved working together, students should assume for their own protection that is not permitted. So many times I find two students that have the same submission. And when I ask them, they basically say, yes, we work together. But the assignment was individual assignment. So the assignment basically was not on a group assignment. You were not supposed to work together for this assignment. Basically, in other classes, like for instance, last semester when I taught foundations of software development, there are group homeworks and group projects. In those, you work together. In 160, we have, at least at this time, no group project. So working together is not allowed. You have to start by yourself writing simple code. This is how you learn, by practicing. And it's not permitted to collaborate. Work, one of you programs the homework with the assistance of the other one, and then you submit it, both of you, separately. That's dishonesty in academic dishonesty. Helping somebody else plagiarizes from one's own homework. For instance, by giving them a copy of yours. So sometimes there is this misconception that if I'm the one giving the homework to somebody else, I'm not the one copying. That's not true. Basically, you supply the homework to somebody else. So it doesn't matter who supplied the homework and who copied it. You are both you're both under academic dishonesty. This also is in the case when you provide a public repository. Like for instance, if you put your homeworks available before the deadline. After the deadline, I do not care. But before the deadline, if the homework is available on the web, what stops anyone else to go and just use it as their own? Representing somebody else's source code as one's own. This is the person that copies as opposed to the person that gives the homework to somebody else. Buying or selling source code. There are websites where you advertise that I paid this much for somebody else to do my homework. It's not allowed, obviously. Using source code from the internet without properly citing the source. So I've seen cases in the lab where students basically would copy the text of the problem and Google it. That's not the point of doing the lab. The point of the lab is start thinking, how do I solve this problem, and then trying to solve it. Okay, so you don't Google the homework problems, because that's not what we want. In this class, we want to learn programming on your own. Now, what happens if there is an instance of academic dishonesty? The university rules are that the instructor makes a recommendation to the academic judiciary office. This is word by word from the website of academic judiciary. And in our computer science department case, cheating is cheating. It doesn't matter that you copied 50% of the homework or 100% of the homework. It's basically cheating. You're cheating yourself. You will not learn programming. You actually learn to copy. And our job is to teach you the material. And our department has a recommendation of F. So when basically we make a recommendation to the academic judiciary, we also have to make a basic recommendation for punishment. And the department has a policy that if we find an instance of dishonesty, the recommendation of the instructor is F. It's not zero for the assignment. Zero for the assignment really means that there is no incentive to not to cheat. Because if you can't do the problem or you copied it from somebody else, you still get zero. In the worst case, that's not the case. Basically, there is one recommendation from the department, you cheat, you end up with an F grade. That's how we maintain the standard, and that's why companies hire our graduates. Now, if there are catastrophic events, I mean, we are living in a pandemic this year, major illness, death in the family, immediately contact the academic advisor for the college, the academic advisor for one of the academic advisors for the department to formulate a plan. Yes, you went through a major illness. Now we have to catch up. That's fine. That's totally fine. There is a system at Stony Brook. We can either give you extensions, end up with an incomplete at the end of the semester, but this needs to be documented by the college, okay? So basically, my advice is that once you pass your event, let's say that you had COVID, you survive and you get better, we formulate a plan. What can we do to finish the grade, the class in a successful manner? So we consider everything. Basically, we have advisors from the student success office. We have advice from the College of Engineering and Applied Sciences. And we basically formulate a plan. When do you finish what assignments? And we get you back on track. Okay. But try to contact us at the first moment. So if one thing that I've seen in the past is that if you start learning late, now you can't catch up, because basically a new assignment comes and you're trying to solve the old assignment and you don't have the capacity to do all of this at once. Okay. So we understand that there was a catastrophic event. You don't need to take the next midterm because basically, or the next exam, because you need extra time. We formulate a plan for a makeup exam. So we'll basically take into consideration what was the period of time that you were out of commission and the period of time that you need to get better. And then we'll basically use that as the time that you will need for the next exam, next homework, and so on. For communication in this class, we use Piazza. So Piazza is actually a nonprofit organization that developed this discussion board. It's like Wikipedia. They survive from donations, either from companies or from individuals. It's a relatively easy to use website where you have all of the messages on the left hand side. You can search through messages that mention various topics like loops or methods, and homework tree or things like that. You are expected to use Piazza for all non-personal course-related communication, because basically asking a technical problem, like troubleshooting a problem, is something of interest to other students in the class. And we can all respond to those questions. So there is me that responds to questions, there are my TAs that respond to questions, there are your colleagues that respond to questions, okay? Now, on Piazza is a luxury. You are not going to have access to Piazza if you cyberbully other students. Like, why do you think that this is a bad code? No, be helpful, be polite. If you don't have anything to communicate or to contribute, don't respond. You don't post memes or links to Twitter on Piazza. You don't complain about a grade. You can complain to my office hours, to me, to the TAs, but basically making a group about complaints is not why we use Piazza. You can air to me concerns, comments. You can air on course evaluations, criticisms of the course, but don't start like a message that doesn't have anything to communicate technically on Piazza. Posting more than a few lines of code is not also allowed. You can post like, how do you do it, but not code, because that's the goal of this class, is for students to write code. Posting the solution of homework or a link to a website that contains the solution is not allowed on Piazza. In general, anything unrelated to the course material and the student learning, okay? Anonymous posting is turned off. So anonymous posting means that you post a message that even I as an instructor don't know who posted it. You can't do that because I actually see who posted it, okay? Email etiquette. So when you do write to me emails, use your official stonybrook.edu email, because by rules, we can't respond to other emails because we are not allowed to write about anything, progress in your class, to other emails than those that are officially only yours, okay? We are not allowed to communicate with your parents about your grades. That's part of the FERPA regulation. And we don't know, as I said earlier, who is whom. Your dog may have an email address. Use a descriptive line like CSE160 when you write. Begin with a proper greeting like, "Hi, Professor Fodor." Briefly explain your question, and I will respond as soon as I can. Sometimes I respond within minutes. And with a proper closing, like goodbye, thank you. What do you need to get started? The Blackwell order count, JDK, as I told you earlier, IDE, Eclipse. You can use other IDEs. I used a lot of different IDEs, and I believe I can help you in any one of them to debug code. That's the most important feature that I will also talk about today. Optionally, you can actually you have here the direct link to Daniel Liang's website for our textbook. What do you need to start? You need to download JDK. Now, when you write the Java program, a Java program is source code, is pure text. You can actually use a standard editor like Notepad or Pico for Linux. You compile your source code into bytecode, Java bytecode, with a command Java C. This can be tedious because you basically make syntax errors. You want to debug your code. It has a poor interactivity. You can also use a second approach, which is an integrated development environment, or what is called an IDE, abbreviated with an IDE. It compiles writing the program, real-time syntax checking, and other compilation errors, like, for instance, that variables are declared before they are used, that the correct type is used in for a variable. You can run the program and debug it in one single application, what I showed you earlier in my Eclipse editor. It makes the coding much more efficient. You have all of the source code files into packages, and you can basically see what you already have. You have different tabs. There are many different IDEs. Eclipse is what I'm using. Really because I like it. I like that there are other programming languages that are integrated as Eclipse plugins. NetBeans is a nice IDE that is developed by Oracle. IntelliJ, as your colleague proposed, is also comes for free for Stony Brook students too. But it's usually paid if you work in a company. How does it work? You write Java source code, like for instance, that Hello World program that I wrote, into a file with extension.java. The name of the file has to be the name of the public class that you have defined in that file. Like for instance, the name of the file, Hello World, for this class that I wrote here, okay? Hello CSE 160 is hello CSE160.java. So this is the file that you basically save for this class. The name of the file has to be the same with the public class that you have defined. Now, if you do it from command line, you have to compile it. So Java is basically a compile language. You write the source code, you compile it with Java C. It produces a binary code, the same name, .class. And then you run it in the Java virtual machine. So Java is a little bit different than other programming languages like C, for instance. C, you compile it directly in the machine level code for that architecture, for Windows Intel architecture, or basically ARM Intel architecture and so on. In the IDE, all of this is invisible, is hidden. Basically, you click on the run menu and you basically the program runs. In fact, what happens internally, the program is compiled into Java bytecode, and the Java bytecode runs into a virtual machine called the Java virtual machine with this run command, Java, and then your program name. Okay. And this basically will run your program. Now, I will go more into details about Java programming in a few moments, but first I want to end the syllabus lecture, which basically says that please be on time. If you want to ask questions, you can ask them at any time. I just saw that there is something in the chat. Java 8 is the best that I want to use for this class, and you should download that version, but it doesn't matter if you download Java 12 also. Please show respect to your classmates. Basically, again, don't cyberbully anyone, be polite. Please turn off your cell phone if your microphone is on. I do exactly the same. I turn off my cell phone before the class, and on topic questions are welcome at any moment. You will find the lecture notes that I went over right now as the first lecture notes on the course website. And as I said, all of the classes are recorded. So let's see if anyone has any question, and then I will stop the recording for the first class, for the first lecture, and I will post it later on the class website. So any questions? If not, I will stop the recording. Thank you. Okay, good. Actually, I didn't stop the recording. I just realized that I stopped the video.